The views expressed on this program are not necessarily the views of Lexington Community Radio or its board of directors. The views expressed are solely those of the programmers.
You are listening to Off the Cuff. Now, here's your host, Adam Banks.
Welcome, everybody, to Off the Cuff. I am Adam Banks coming at you live from Lexington, Kentucky. Thank you for listening to the show, and thank you for tuning in to WLXU 93.9 FM. In addition to listening on the radio, you can check out our Facebook live stream at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks, or you could stream the show live from the station website at radiolex.us to listen to the show from anywhere in the entire world. It is May the 30th, 2024. I am broadcasting from the Deborah Hensley Studios here at Radio Lex on North Limestone. And a lot of the times, folks, when I am just chilling out, waiting to get on the air, I just scroll on TikTok, on Instagram, like many, many people do. And I come across just this video that disturbed me, and that's actually what I want to start the show about. I came across this girl on one of the, it was either Reels, Instagram, whichever, but she, her dad had passed away, and they were going through her dad's things when he passed, and she found in her dad's belongings a porn stash that he had, and it was an impressive porn stash that he had. It was a ton of VHS, a ton of DVDs, a plethora of material that could be used for a pornographic library. And my man definitely lived in the older generation, because nowadays, you want to look up something like that, you just go online and look it up. Used to, you had to get pornographic videos on DVD, on VHS. So she started going through her dad's things, and she really brought to the people's attention, because she was recording the video, she really brought it to people's attention that he collected porn, because she was laughing about it and hee-heeing and ha-hawing. And making a big joke out of it, people were loving it, people were laughing because of the names of the porn movies were pretty just silly. But then I started thinking about the man who had just passed, a very respectable man who was having his dirty laundry and just having his private stuff aired on social media like that after he died. And it made me start thinking about just death in general. You know, when we die, because eventually we all will die. And one day, everything how we left it when we die will just be how it is. However we leave our things, one day it will forever be left like that. Because one day we're all going to leave the house for the last time. We're all going to get out of our car for the last time. We're all going to leave a certain place for the last time. So we leave certain things and certain spaces a certain way for the last time, because we don't really know when our last time is going to be. So have you really ever started thinking about that? When you die, when you pass away, there will be people that go through your things. There will be people that will comb through every detail of your house. Those hiding spots where you think you got things hidden, oh, they'll find them. Even in the most meticulous places, somebody will find your belongings. And a lot of people just don't think about that. They think, well, I'll be dead. I don't care what they find. Well, when you say that, but at the end of the day, maybe your legacy is all you got. So if there are, or if people are just going through your things just to make fun of you for what you had, or if you have anything left behind, and we all do, that you don't want people to see, you might want to take care of that and keep and be mindful of, hey, one day if I ever die, there's going to be somebody to come through my house and see this. So if you've got any DVDs or any VHSs or any pictures that you want to never be discovered, don't think they're in a safe place just because they're in your best hiding place. Because one day you will die and you won't be able to guard those places like you're so used to doing. And it made me start thinking about just dying in general and what life is going to be like for that person that is not here anymore. Your family sometimes is left with a lot of unanswered things about somebody's life when they die because we don't know what somebody does in their everyday. Right, my family knows me. My mom knows me, my dad knows me, my sister, my brothers. They know who I am, but they don't know what I do every day. They don't know who I've met. They don't know who I date. They don't know anything really about what I do in my everyday. So a lot of the times people are shocked when somebody dies and they discover new things about them once they pass away. For instance, you might go to somebody's funeral and there might be people that show up at the funeral that you have no idea who they are, but they could have been really close to your own brother, to your own husband, your own wife, your own sister, and you didn't even know who they were. And I'm talking this person could have been a secret lover that they never told about. It's easy to spot those. Those people, those secret lovers are the ones standing in the distance, crying the hardest, and nobody knows who they are. Chances are that was probably a secret lover from somebody's past. Or what about if your family member had mafia ties, or they were in some type of crime gang, or a biker gang that you just never knew about, and then you found out about it because of the funeral, the people who showed up at the funeral. There's a lot of things like that that happens. And there's so many secrets that can pop up once somebody passes away. You might find out things when you start going through the person who's died things. You might find out things about them that you do not like. You might find things out about them that will tarnish the way you feel about them going forward for the rest of your life. For instance, what if you found out that the grandpa that used to buy you ice cream every Sunday morning was a member of the KKK, and you had no idea that that was the case, but you're going through his things after he passes, and you're going through his closet, and you find a KKK outfit, a robe, with all of the stuff and the secrets and the books hidden in a trunk in his closet. Yeah, you can go and burn the stuff and try to never think of it again, but it's still there. It's still in your mind. There's all kinds of things that you might find out about somebody that you are not ready to find out. So you might find drugs. You might have never known that your favorite daughter smoked pot. Well, you might find pot in her house when you go and search through her things. Is that going to make you feel a certain way about them? Because I'm here to tell you, nobody tells you everything about them. Everybody will say, I'm an open book. Everybody knows everything about me. No, they don't. No, they don't. There are things that you do behind closed doors that nobody has any idea other than you. But once you pass away, there is no guard on that door anymore. Those hiding places are now public. So there's a lot of things that you can find out. Sexual scandals, finding porn stashes, drug stashes. You can find out things that people kept hidden for years. You can find old love letters. Hey, wives. Hey, husbands. Are you ready and prepared to go through your lover's things and find old love letters that they had hidden away? That could happen. That could still be there. One day, my point of this whole thing is one day, we're all going to die. And one day, we're all going to leave physical, tangible stuff behind. You just have to ask yourself, am I ready for that really to be seen? Am I ready for all of that really to be shown? And while you're still here, make arrangements to get that taken care of, because you just never know. But food for thought here on this Thursday, Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. But folks, we still have a great show ahead of you today. Stick with us. We will be right back. Adam Banks here with you. A lot of people chiming in on the show thread talking about our first segment. You know, when you lose somebody that lived with you, their belongings, when they die, are still around, from their toothbrush in the bathroom to their clothes in the laundry hamper to their books that they were reading on the nightstand to their keys by the door. Everywhere you turn, there's a reminder of that person. So seeing some of those items could be comforting. But the thing that I wanted to drive home to people is that, yes, those are items we are aware of every day that reminds us of people. But you have to be mindful of the things that you're going to be leaving behind that you don't want people to discover. And sometimes it's more than just the tangible physical thing. Sometimes it's a relationship. So take care of that stuff while you're still here. This is an old school NBA team song for the 76ers. It's called 1-2-3-4-5-6ers. Back in the day, NBA teams, a lot of them, used to have their own personalized NBA song for the team. Now, what's interesting about this is not every NBA team has a personalized song. You know, for instance, the Chicago Bulls, they just have that infamous music that they come out to before they announce the starting lineup. The Lakers, one of the most iconic teams in the NBA, doesn't even have a NBA team song. But there are still songs out there that exist that belong solely to NBA teams. There are NBA teams that specifically have their own NBA team songs. And this is one of the great ones. This is from the Philadelphia 76ers. This song is called 1-2-3-4-5-6ers. Some call this song Here Come the Sixers. It's just a simple song with simple lyrics and simple math, but it's still a classic. And I play this because I got a lot of feedback on the show the other day when I was playing the NBA theme musics, the theme music from network, different networks. And one of the things that I played was the old CBS theme, and why people love that theme so much was because the song actually had lyrics to it. And it made me start thinking of, well, do NBA teams have songs personalized for them? Not all of them, but some of them do. So what I have done is I have went back and searched through some of the old school NBA team songs throughout time. And I have created a list, and that's what I would like to share for you guys today. We'll start with the Philadelphia 76ers, this song, 1-2-3-4-5-6ers. And there are a ton more. Now, to make this list, you actually, this can't be just, yeah, anybody, any local rapper can take a team that they like, that they're a fan of, and go to their laptop computer and throw down some horrible lyrics and music to a song. I'm not talking about those kind of NBA songs. I'm talking about official NBA team songs that the actual NBA team used themselves. And not every NBA team did this, but a lot did. And we'll start with this one right here on the list. But there are a ton more. For instance, there is this theme from the Washington Bullets, You Do, You Demand. Yes. Now, the Washington Bullets obviously aren't in existence anymore, but back when they were in the 90s, they were the hip, cool team, and they had this hip, cool rap song that the actual team used as their team song. Now, the Washington Bullets, they were a collection of characters. They had a 7'7 Romanian guy. They had two members of the Fab Five from Michigan. They had a no-nonsense future Hall of Fame coach. They were just the team of the 90s that was cool. They were the cool team of the 90s. Yeah, there's the Bulls, and nobody can top the Bulls in the 90s, but as far as coolness, that was the Washington Bullets. Washington Bullets are in your town. coming from the capital of the nation. My man Chris Webber slam dunks in your face. And all right, coming up next on my list as one of the best NBA team songs throughout time comes from the Cleveland Cavaliers. Cleveland Cavaliers won their first NBA world title just 4 years ago with LeBron James. But, folks, they have a great team theme song, and it's called Come On Cavs.
Come on, Cavs. Gotta make it happen. Come on, Cavs.
There was a local radio personality that created this jingle. It was created by writer Larry Morrow. It cost $10,000 to make this jingle. And this jingle was just made their official team song. So it was created for a radio commercial, but the Cavs liked it so much, they said, hey, we're going to use this jingle as our official NBA team song. Julian C. Barbara is the man behind the voice of the lyrics. Now, the Cavaliers, they've had multiple team theme songs throughout the years, but this one is the most notable. This one came in 1974.
Cavaliers basketball is what it's all about.
I love it. Anytime a song has that old school just feel to it, that old school sound to it, I'm here for it. I like it. Okay, coming up next on my list is one of the best NBA team songs throughout time. Comes from the Detroit Pistons. This song is called Three-Peat Beat. This is a high-tempo hip-hop song that appeared in the spring of 1991. You guys remember the back-to-back Detroit Piston champions. Well, they were gunning for a three-peat in 1991. So in 1991, they came out with this song, and it became the official Detroit Piston song. Now, I think since the 90s, they have dropped this song, but they don't really use it anymore. But man, this was the song they used in 91 all year, over and over and over. It's hard to use a song called three-peat when you lose after your two-peat. Can't really use it anymore. But boy, oh boy, did they have a great team song just for a year and 1 year only. The Bad Boy Pistons. What a team that was. Bill Laimbeer. Why can't I think of the point guard's name? Oh my gosh. The Detroit Piston Bad Boys. Okay, coming up next on my list, Isaiah Thomas. Excuse me, that's it. I knew it was coming to me. It was going to bother me until it came into my head. Okay, coming up next on my list, folks, as one of the best NBA team songs throughout time, comes from the Houston Rockets, and this one is called That's My Team.
Mr. Lou.
Houston Rockets.
That's my team.
Houston Rockets.
That's my team.
This song was created for the Houston Rockets as the team song back in 2008. And it was an effort that name drops not only Tracy McGrady and Yao Ming, but also Carl Landry, Luis Scola, and Steve Novick. The song uses the chopped and screwed rap music style that originated in Houston, where DJs take songs, slow them down significantly, and repeat the lyrics.
We the best in the West. We headed to the finals and won't settle for less. Aaron Brooks, Chuck.
Doug Hayes, Bobby Jackson, Mutombo, the Shane Battier, ready for
action. This is a song that just kind of talks about the history of the team, some of their former legends. And this was the Houston Rockets team song. Okay, next on my list comes from the Memphis Grizzlies. They had one of the best NBA team songs throughout time. This one is called We Don't Bluff. And this song came after a certain player was ejected from a game in 2012 for nearly fighting with the other team. The Memphis native DJ Paul got in the studio and ended up writing a song for his favorite NBA team and his local team, the Memphis Grizzlies, which they used this song for years and years and years. I think eventually they have dropped it, or they went on to drop it, but this song was something they used for a long, long time. Okay, coming up next on my list is one of the best NBA team songs throughout time. Comes from, and this is one of my favorites, the Milwaukee Bucks. Yes, the Bucks don't stop here. You know, it's a playoff. The Buck don't stop here. Well, the Bucks, or the Buck stops here. The Bucks don't stop here. I love that. This sounds like an old 70s, 80s sitcom.
The Bucks don't stop here.
This song was released in 1977, and it served as the intro song to the Bucks telecast for years and years and years afterwards. So this became the official team theme song. Okay, coming up next on my list as one of the best NBA team songs throughout time comes from the New York Knicks. And this one's called Go New York, Go.
We are the New York Knicks. We are the New York Knicks. We are the New York Knicks. We are the New York Knicks.
Say go New York, go New York, go.
Go New York, go New York, go.
Say go New York, go New York, go.
Go New York, go New York, go.
The Knicks, they remade this catchy song a few times. The original version was a reference from their 1994 finals team. They created another version in 1999, which is what you're hearing now, and then they created another version in 2012-2013. Very similar, just different versions.
Playing D, Houston launching jumps from the top of the key, and Ward, you and Charles and Larry, Thomas, Big Chris, and Marcus can be. Nobody does it like the Knicks can. Go get your best five guys, in fact, grab a six man. The three well and the Knicks excel. Look out, the number 18 starts to gel.
Go New York, go New York, go!
Man, New York, it's a city and a state full of songs written about it. Even the basketball team has a great song written about it. Go, New York, go. Okay, coming up next on my list is one of the best NBA team songs throughout time. Comes from the Portland Trailblazers with their team song, Bust a Bucket. Bust a Bucket.
Bust, bust.
Now, there is actually a pretty cool video online that goes along with this song, and it's an official video posted by the Portland Trailblazers, and the video is members of their team lip-syncing the lyrics to the song, so it looks like that they're singing the songs themselves. Obviously, they're lip-syncing, but it's a really good visual with the song.
But the ball don't deck me, knock me cold, disconnect me. Next thing I know,
and if you go to a Portland Trailblazers game, this is what you will hear.
This is going to be hotter than I thought. on that.
Okay, coming up next on my list as one of the best NBA team songs throughout time comes from, and this is another one of my personal favorites. This actually might be my favorite. This is from the Seattle Supersonics, who are no longer in existence. But when they were back in 92, 93, during that season, they wrote and released this song, Not in Our House, by the famous rapper Sir Mix-a-Lot.
It's the 9 tray, y'all, and the Supersonics is all at Nebola Grip. So I hope you can handle this full court pressure I'm about to drop on these fools. 2017's is trying, but 2016's ain't getting there. But the strong will survive, and the weak will fall by the wayside, suckers. Take your high tops and your whack shots to the hot shop.
Love it. Yes, Sir Mix-a-Lot. You know, I like big butts and I cannot lie. You other brothers can't deny. Same guy. And when you can get that guy to write a song about your NBA team, you're doing something right. And then finally, the last song on the list of one of the best NBA team songs throughout time comes from the Miami Heat, and this one's called We Already Won by Flo Rida.
That's not y'all know.
Oh boy.
And this theme sounds like an R&B song with a gospel choir, like a old 90s song. And this song was released in 2012, back when they had Dwayne Wade, LeBron James, Chris Bosh, and they were chasing, LeBron was chasing his first NBA title. They released the song in 2012, 2013, and they released it close to the finals run. Now, since the Miami Heat disbanded that iconic team that they once had, they no longer use this song. But it was a great song why it was still here. And folks, I bring all of this up because we are slap dab in the middle of the NBA playoffs. The NBA playoffs are now officially going to be... The playoffs are officially now in play. We are only down to three teams left. The Boston Celtics just eliminated the Indiana Pacers. So the Boston Celtics are officially in the finals. And now we have Minnesota Timberwolves and the Dallas Mavericks still battling it out to see who's going to get in the finals there. So it could be between those two. Could be Boston Celtics against either the Minnesota Timberwolves or the Dallas Mavericks. But because of that, folks, and because we are slap dab into the NBA playoffs, I just wanted to do yet again another NBA-themed topic. So that are some of the best NBA team songs that exist out there. All right, folks, we have lots more Off the Cuff with Adam Banks coming at you live after these words. Stick with us. We will be right back.
So you're still thinking of me, just like I know you should. I cannot give you everything, you know I wish I could.
Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Folks, it is graduation season. Graduation has been happening all over the country for all colleges, high schools, grade schools, you name it. This is the time where people are graduating, and we still have a few graduations left. Usually the schools from the rural areas don't graduate until June because of snow and whatnot. But nonetheless, we still are in graduation season. And this is the time when many seniors are passing around their yearbook, and you have to think of something to write in the yearbook that you get. And what you write in somebody's yearbook is pretty important because sometimes that's all they remember you by, the message that you leave in their yearbook. So don't you want to write something memorable in their yearbook? One of the best things to do when you have nothing really to write to somebody, you don't really know them, you don't really know what to say, is to put in a nice quote. People love quotes. We used to have a whole segment on this show, a reoccurring segment We called it Off the Cuff's quote of the week. Quotes are just a great antidote for anything. A message in a letter, a message in a yearbook, a great way to start off a speech, a great way to close a speech. People love quotes. That's why you walk into Hobby Lobby and you see picture frames with quotes in them everywhere. So graduation quotes are a little different, though. Graduation quotes can be used in a variety of ways, such as not only writing it in somebody's yearbook, but commencement speeches, social media posts, greeting cards. But sometimes senior classes, they have their own senior class quote where the whole class has to kind of vote on a list of quotes that they feel like is the best. And that quote that wins becomes the official quote of that senior class. Graduation quotes can inspire graduates to embrace the future with optimism. And quotes can make high school students have a sense of adventure. They can also provide guidance and wisdom during a time of transition. Graduation quotes can motivate graduates to reach their goals and continue to improve on themselves and their life. Graduation, as we know, is a significant accomplishment that can be celebrated with a quote that reflects on the person's hard work, their dedication, and the success that led to it. So I started thinking about all of the different great high school quotes that are out there, quotes that could be used for a graduation quote, a high school senior class. I can't remember what my high school senior class quote was, but I would like to share with the audience, and this is really a segment for you upcoming seniors, so those who just finished their junior year, this is really a segment for you because it's now time for you to start thinking about maybe what you want your future senior class quote to be, and you maybe want to get prepared already of what you're wanting to say in somebody's yearbook when they pass it to you. Or maybe you're a senior right now and you haven't got a chance to sign the yearbook. I'm going to go over the best graduation quotes for high school seniors to use, for high school senior classes to use. Now, you can use this quote as the high school senior class, or you can just use this as your personal quote. I have a whole list here that I would like to share, and here are the ones that I find are the best. This first quote is by Charles Schulz. He says, "Don't worry about the world coming to an end today. It's already tomorrow in Australia." Terry Pratchett said, "The trouble with having an open mind, of course, is that people will insist on coming along and trying to put things in it." Jay-Z said, "I'm not a businessman. I'm a business man." Taylor Swift said, "Long story short, I survived." Ooh, I like that one. You could use that one as your own personal one, or the whole senior class could use that one as their senior class quote. Vital Sasson said, in quote, she said, "The only place where success comes before work is in the dictionary." Ooh, that's a good one to personally write in someone's yearbook if you're trying to motivate them. Henry Youngman says, "If you're going to do something tonight that you'll be sorry for tomorrow morning, just sleep late." John Lennon says, "Life is what happens to you while you're busy making other plans." Joe Dirt says, "Life's a garden. Dig it." Kurt Vonnegut says, "True terror is to wake up one morning and discover that your high school class is running the country." That's a good one to use in a graduation speech to be tongue-in-cheek. Alfred Alder says, "Follow your heart, but take your brain with you." Absolutely. Sometimes we do use our heart. We go with our heart, but we always got to make sure our brain is still with us. We want to make sure of that. And Paul Ville says, "Wait, we're supposed to have a quote?" I love that one. And then finally, Jimmy Duggan from the movie A League of Their Own quoted this, and you could use this as your quote. He quoted, "It's supposed to be hard. If it were easy, everyone would do it. So there you go, folks. Those are some of the best graduation quotes for high school senior classes to use. But I feel like that this is a great time to take Off the Cuff's Song of the Week break, and I've got a new Hot 100 Billboard chart song to play for you, and that is by Miss Billie Eilish with her new hit song, Lunch. We'll be back after the song.
I could eat that girl for lunch as she dances on my tongue.
A lot of people on the show thread are asking for an encore of graduation quotes. They want it to continue. So must meet the audience command of what they want and what they want to hear. Here are some more graduation quotes that high school senior classes can use. Here's another one by William Shakespeare. Love all, trust a few, do wrong to none. The narrator from the movie The Fight Club said, "You met me at a very strange time in my life." I think that would be a great high school senior class quote. You met me at a very strange time in my life. I mean, high school is a very strange time for teenagers. It was a strange time in my life. I know it was a strange time in a lot of people's life. So it would be a great senior quote. Here's another great one from The Office. Dwight says, "I am ready to face any challenges that might be foolish enough to face me." Dita Von Teese said, quote, "You can be the ripest, juiciest peach in the world, and there's still going to be someone who hates peaches." This one come from Barney Stinson, a character off the TV show How I Met Your Mother. He said, quote, "When I'm sad, I stop being sad and just be awesome instead." Well, I wish it could be easier said than done there, Barney. Chimamanda Adichie says, "It's not your job to be likable. It's your job to be yourself." Homer Simpson from The Simpsons said, "All of my life, I've had one dream, to achieve my many goals." I love that. It's kind of makes me think of having a genie to only grant you three wishes. If I had a genie to only grant me three wishes, my first wish would be to have an unlimited amount of wishes. Kind of found a loophole there to keep the genie around a lot longer. A Song of Solomon, in the show Song of Solomon, Toni Morrison said, "Want to fly? You got to give up the things that weighs you down." I love that. Chuck Palonsky says, "May I never be complete. May I never be content. May I never be perfect." Chandler Bing from Friends quoted, "I'm not great at the advice. Can I interest you in a sarcastic comment?" And then two more here. Michael Scott from The Office said in the TV show The Office, "You miss 100% of the shots you don't take." I'm pretty sure that was Michael Jordan that said that, but anyway. And then finally, Tina Fey said, quote, "Do your thing and don't care if they like it." And that, folks, is a bunch of high school senior quotes that high school seniors can use. Elaine on the show thread says, "Don't forget Forrest Gump's, life is like a box of chocolates. You never will know what you're going to get." Very true. And one of the most truest statements that you can ever be heard on a movie, because it makes so much sense. Life is really like a box of chocolates. You really don't know what you're going to get when you open that thing and you bite into the chocolate. It's a surprise, just like life. All right, folks, stick with us. We still have one more segment to go. We will be right back. Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Last segment of the hour. If your name is Jennifer, today is your day, because today's national holiday is National Jennifer Day, and it's celebrated on May 30th of every year. So it's a special day for all of you Jennifers out there. If you have a special Jennifer in your life, let her know that today is her day, and let her know how much you feel about her. A ton of famous Jennifers around the world. We've got this particular Jennifer. We've got Jennifer Lopez. We've got Jennifer Aniston. We've got a ton of Jennifers. Now, Jennifer, it says, became a popular name in 1915 with the help of Broadway. There was a Broadway play called The Doctor's Dilemma, and it promoted the name Jennifer in that play, and that's when it really started to pick up. And then in the 50s, it really started to gain popularity. Jennifer makes it to the top 100 popular names in the U.S. In 1972, according to data from the U.S. Social Security Administration, a total of 63,603 babies bear the name Jennifer. It was the highest recorded use of the name, and that was in the year of 1972. Here are some facts about the name Jennifer. Jennifers are known to be sweet, hot, and attract lots of suitors. So Jennifers are known to be attractive. Another fun fact about Jennifers is they are considered to be problem solvers. They are considered to be dependable and determined. They are considered to be intimidating. So a ton of famous Jennifers out there: Aniston, Lopez, Jennifer Connelly, Jennifer Lawrence, Jennifer Hudson. The list is endless. So if you know a Jennifer, let her know that today is her day, and it is National Jennifer Day. Before we go, folks, I just want to make mention, and I meant to mention it on the second segment when I was talking about the NBA. Bill Walton, he passed away, an icon in the world of basketball. Arguably, he should be in the conversation as one of the best to ever do it. He won 3 national titles in college with John Wooden. 3. Not 1, not 2, 3 college national titles as a college player, and then went to the NBA and won 2 world NBA titles. And when you win titles, that's one thing. But when you are one of the biggest reasons they won the title, that's another. Bill Walton, he led his teams to those titles. So to hear that he passed away was very, very sad. And I didn't even know he had cancer. It's one of those things that sometimes people just pass away. They don't want you to know that they're sick. They don't want to have the stares. They don't want to have the sympathy. They don't want that. They're very private. So it was just another shocking thing to hear that he had cancer. It says here that he led the Portland Trailblazers to an NBA championship in 1977. And let's see. Yes. So did he just win one? I thought he won 2 national titles. I thought he won 2 NBA titles, but I guess it was just the one. But he did win 3 college titles in 72, 73, and 1978. Nope, he did win 2 NBA titles. He won another one with the Celtics. So, yes, should have went with my gut feeling on that there. He was inducted into the Naismith Memorial Basketball Hall of Fame in 1993 and was named to the NBA's 50th and 75th anniversary teams. One of the best to ever do it. So, yes, the NBA is in the forefront of everybody's mind, everybody's viewing material right now with the playoffs going on. So keep him in mind, and if you are wondering who that is, and it's not coming to your head right off the bat of who that is, he was a big star in the 70s and the 80s, but do yourself a favor and go look up his stuff. The man was so talented, and the man has to be in the conversation as one of the best to ever do it. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that pretty much wraps another episode of Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. If you liked what you heard today, you'll probably like our previous episodes. We have all of them archived on our podcast at Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever you stream your favorite podcast. You can follow the show on social media at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. You can follow me, the host, on social media at The Adam Banks. We release new episodes every Thursday right here from 4 to 5 right here on WLXU 93.9 FM, which means we will be back same time, same place. Ladies and gentlemen, I am Adam Banks, and this is Off the Cuff. You are listening to the King of Radio. I will see you next Thursday.